I'm at a UFC thing. So. Yes, no, yes, yes. All right, all right. We're just trying to get all the bugs worked out. We welcome you on Facebook Live. This is still very, very weird. But I suppose you're wondering why we are all in our pajamas. Because most of you are in your pajamas. And we know it. We can see you, believe it or not. And so we know you're in your jammies, so we thought, well, in our never-ending attempt to be pastoral and caring, we wanted to identify with the congregation, with the flock, and so we decided to wear our jammies as well. So let's worship the Lord together in our jammies. Annette?
All right. Heavenly Father, thank you for this time that we get to spend. Lord, I just ask that you would be with each and every one of us wherever we are to worship with you. Father, I just ask that you would indwell each and every one of us and allow us to bless you in your name. Amen.
As you are to worship, just as you are before your God. Come, come, just as you are. Come, just as you Hosanna in the highest. To my home far away.
you so much that you went to that old rugged cross for us. Father, while we celebrate this week, Father, as we look back at the week that you had 2,000 years ago, Father, that people went from singing Hosanna to you to shouting crucify him in less than a week. Father, I can't even begin to imagine what it was like. But Father, I thank you for taking that journey. I thank you for taking on our sin, for taking on my sin, so that I could share with you in that glory someday. And Father, we just thank you and give you the praise in your name. Amen. Well, if you have two or more with you, please turn and greet one another. And we will be right back with you. Oh, and if you have not gathered elements for communion, we will be taking communion later. So run to the kitchen and grab what you can.
Well, hello again, Facebook family, and for all of those that are joining us that are normally a part of our fellowship, and those of you that are joining us that aren't, we welcome all of you. Last week, we did something a little different with an interview. We don't do that often, but I got a lot of feedback that people really appreciated getting to know folks a little bit better and being able to kind of hear their story a little bit. And so what I've been trying to do is to latch on to some things that have been happening currently and bring them to your attention rather than just as an announcement, being able to do sort of an interview type of format. All of you know Annette. Annette Holstein has been heading up our worship department for some time, and I really appreciate all of you back in the audiovisual booth back there. See, by the way, the whole pajama thing, for those of you joining us late, the pajamas are because you're probably in pajamas, and so we thought we would go ahead and wear ours as well. But just so that you know, the audiovisual team, every weekend, they're, I think, wearing pajamas, but they're back behind the booth and you just don't notice. So when we start meeting back together again, make sure all of you take a chance to check back there and see what they're wearing. But you all know Annette, she's been helping us, leading worship. But I wanted to take a few moments and dive into a couple of other things that I think, first of all, will be encouraging for our flock, but also will be an idea for you to know some things that we have going on during this time when everybody seems to be sequestered. So now, for those who don't know, share just a little bit of how you came to know Christ. Just a little bit.
Do I still have the song? Yeah. Well, I was told that I was saved when I was 4 years old. And I grew up in a church. My grandpa was a four-square preacher. And my dad was the choir director because they didn't have worship teams back then. And my dad was quite a drummer, but drums were not allowed in the church. So he was the choir director. My mom was in the choir. So I was always at the church. I grew up at the church. And I followed the Lord closely as a child, but then at 17, I got a job at a very popular amusement park and made some friends there that I shouldn't have and kind of strayed for a while. And when I turned 19, I found out I was pregnant at 19 and had Christopher, and it made me realize, oh, guess I haven't been following the Lord the way I should have, and started going back to church, and I thought everything was great. And then a couple years later, I decided to counsel some of the junior high girls at a junior high camp. Haven't done that since. But while we were
I can't buy a selfie.
While we were up there, the Lord just kept nudging me and saying, hey, you know what? You kind of just came back, but you didn't really make any kind of a commitment. So while I was counseling junior high girls, I made my full commitment to the Lord at that point. I was 21, 22, and I've been serving the Lord ever since. Yeah, that's
awesome.
Pretty much it. I've been involved in worship my whole life.
It's been great to have you helping us here. It's just been a real blessing. So something occurred recently that I think would be encouraging to the folks to know, just because I've watched you handle this with grace and class, and it's never easy to have a dream shattered. And I know that recently you had that kind of a scenario happen. Can you share a little bit about that?
Absolutely. For those that don't know, I tried to get into the sheriff's department as a 911 operator for 7 years, and I finally got in, and I was so excited because this has been something that I'd really wanted for a long time. My stepdad, his health ailed for a long time, and I kept seeing all the first responders come out to the house for him. When my grandpa passed away, I kept seeing them, and I just wanted to be a part of that, and I knew that I did not have the physical ability to be a cop or firefighter or anything. So I thought 911 is a great place for me. I could do this. You know, I had the attitude for it. Turns out that I was a little too detail-oriented and focused were the words that they used, and I'd never heard those used derogatory before. But it just wasn't a good fit. I went through about 6 months of training, and it just wasn't happening. I was not getting it the way I should have. And so it looked like they were on, they told me they were on this path to likely terminate me if I didn't resign, which I understood because,
sure,
you know, it just wasn't working out. So I went ahead and resigned.
How you handled that in the aftermath, I think, was telling so many people, I think when that happens, wanted something, now I have the chance, and then for some reason it just doesn't come to fruition. We just want to go home and crawl under a rock.
Well, I actually came to the realization and shared with a couple of people that I kept thinking about the Israelites and how they wanted a king, they wanted a king, they wanted a king, they wanted a king, and God finally said, okay, here, have it, you know, and it wasn't exactly what they were looking for, and I kind of felt like God was saying, okay, fine, you want to do this, let's do this. Now you see why I didn't give it to you those last couple of years. But honestly, you know, my respect for that office is just as high or higher than it ever was. They are wonderful, wonderful people. And God just has something else out there for me. I don't know what it is, but he's seen me through rougher times. He's seen me through a lot of rougher times. And he'll see me through this one.
That's awesome. I hope that's encouraging for other people, because we all face crushed dreams, shattered dreams, and then how do we deal with that and letting the Lord minister to us. And I will take the chance to give a shout out to all of those that work in dispatch and 911, that whole system.
You guys rock!
Yeah, I mean, they're often the forgotten portion. I know that when Scott went through the shooting that he went through, I was blessed to know that our chaplaincy course sent a chaplain up to dispatch, because so often they're the ones that are sending us out on the calls, and as a deputy, I get to the call, I get to somewhat resolve that call. They rarely get the resolution on the other side.
And they're the first responders.
Yeah, and so, you know, for everyone who's listening, you know, take a moment to pray for those who work behind the scenes and in dispatch areas as well. And so the last thing I wanted to talk about, I think it will be an encouragement and an announcement for those that don't know. You're out of work now, so if anybody has a job, but seriously.
Detail-oriented, yes, focused.
Yes, exactly. But you've taken the opportunity to come down here, and last week you came down and you just played and sang hymns. Mm-hmm. And we put it out on Facebook Live. I know Diane came down, and thank you, Diane, for doing that. Came down and put it out on Facebook Live. And it's been amazing, the response. I mean, absolutely astounding how much response we have seen online
from that. So tell us a little bit how that was birthed and what you're doing.
While I was trying to figure out what I was doing with 911 being in the past, I kept thinking about the fact that I wanted to do something for hospice, something for convalescent homes. And I was trying to think, you know, what can I do? What, as far as everybody's being sent home, nobody's hiring right now. And asking the Lord, what can I do in this day and age? And it came to me that as I grew up in the church, I love the old hymns. Old Rugged Cross, that's bread and butter for me. I love the old hymns. And a couple of weeks ago, I asked on Facebook, what are some of the old hymns that you guys miss your church doing? I got such an overwhelming response between that post and all the messages that I received.
I know it made me afraid. I was
watching. Yes, pastor's thing was, Annette, don't go crazy. But my idea was to come down here and just do the Facebook thing with hymns and then send out the links to some of the convalescent homes and the hospitals or hospices in the area and beyond. And if they wanted to, because a lot of the people that are in those places are the people that keep asking for hymns. That older generation.
Now, you couldn't go down to the nursing home
right now
and play.
So right. Awesome. So, and this way, I'm able to get it out to more than just one. You know, if I send the link, they can put it up on their screen and let as many people that want to, that miss those old songs that have such rich theology in them, that they can just come in and sing along and remember those beautiful days back at church and when they were vibrant and able to jump and dance and sing and clap and whatever, but just to give them some comfort and to give them, to let them know that somebody's out there for them.
That's fantastic. So if folks go to our Springs Lighthouse Facebook page and go to the videos, they'll see that amongst many videos. We've been doing devotionals nearly daily. I've been giving updates and how things are working around here and all of that. But they will see the video of you sitting at the piano. That's the one. And doing those hymns. And then
there's about 5 more weeks worth. So because of the response that I got, I've got about 50 songs. Right. There's about 5 more coming. Yes.
Any idea when yet?
It looks like we're going to do Wednesdays. Wednesday, 11:30, somewhere in there.
Fantastic. Well, Father, I pray that you would bless this endeavor. Father, that this would go far beyond just the folks that are a part of Springs Lighthouse. But, Lord, you would use it to minister to this community, to other communities. Father, the people that are hearing about this right now would drop a note or an email to a nursing home near where they are, or maybe where their grandparents are or parents, and be able to encourage them that this is available for their folks. And Lord, I pray that hearts would be touched, and that you would continue to impact people's lives. Lord, we hold value to you, no matter what age we are, from the unborn to the aged. Lord, you care deeply about us, and especially for that older group that is so hit by this virus right now, that has probably a greater fear level or at least concern level than any of the rest of us. Lord, minister to them by this endeavor, and bless Annette and Diane for putting this together and for doing this. Lord, I pray that you would encourage them in this, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
No hands. Yes, I didn't get the memo about PJs, sorry. Just as a reminder, we are doing communion, so please feel free to grab whatever elements you want to use. That's between you and the Lord. Wise Woman Getaway, the planning is for the getaway is moving forward for now. We will keep you posted if anything changes. Registration runs through April 12th. Getaway location is still going to be at Quaker Ridge Camp, April 24th through the 26th. The cost is $200. Good Friday prayer and communion. So on this Friday, Good Friday, on April 10th, from 11 to 1, we'll have the sanctuary open for a time of prayer and reflection. We can come in, take communion, and just sit with the Lord and thank him for all he's done. We will be limiting how many people that are in here, and we'll be taking all the precautions that we can with everything that's going on. Men's breakfast and study is canceled until further notice. Easter online service, Sunday, April 12th at 10 a.m., so we will not be doing it Saturday night. And we are still accepting gift cards for the deputies that were injured. If you want to send well wishes, cards, just a sign of thank you to them, send them to the church, and we'll get that into the right hands. And Brian, come on back up. I know you were comfortable, but come back up. And go ahead and turn to John 12:37.
Thanks, Kent. I'm touching this because it's my mic. All right. John chapter 12, verse 37. And while you're turning there, again, a reminder that we are very, very cognizant of the issues that we're dealing with social distancing and taking care of communion elements, that kind of thing. We are going to space them out in the trays. We're going to make sure that people don't have to do anything but touch their particular communion elements. And if you want to come in here with gloves on, that's fine, but we encourage you to come by on Good Friday. Just maintain your distance from one another. If you're wearing masks, that's fine. You'll figure out how to get the bread and the cup underneath your mask. All right? So John chapter 12, verse 37 is where we are in our text. And Father, we thank you so much for allowing us to have this time, even online, Lord. Where two or three are gathered, you are in our midst. And Lord, I somehow feel like that has to also work in a scenario such as this. And so, Father, we pray that your Spirit would work through your word. Lord, that you would touch hearts, that you would encourage us as to who you are and who we are in your sight. And Father, that you would minister to our lives in such a way that we would be able to continue through this difficult time as a nation and around the world with joy and with peace in our hearts, because you are our God. You are our rock. You are the refuge that we run to. You are the strong tower that we trust in and that we rest upon. And so, Father, minister to the hearts of your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, as we approach chapter 13, which obviously we won't get into next week because next week will be Easter Sunday. We have a special text there. And again, a reminder, one Easter service, 10 o'clock. We changed everything up. So 10 o'clock, it will be on Facebook Live. And then after the fact, we will put it also up on our YouTube channel and onto the website. But when we get into chapter 13, there's another shift in John's gospel. And so finishing out chapter 12 tonight, for those of you that tomorrow morning, whenever you watch, we are finishing out chapter 12 and closing out Jesus' public ministry. Getting into chapter 13, John will deal with only, so chapters 13 through 21 is roughly the last 24 to 36 hours of Jesus' earthly life. I want to back up and kind of take a running start into this chapter, because verses 35 and 36, we covered them last week, but they become important in some of the things that Jesus says in our text tonight. Unfortunately, we needed to break it for time's sake, but Jesus, John, when he wrote this, didn't break it. Jesus is not breaking it in the things that he's saying. So John chapter 12, verse 35, Jesus said to them, "A little while longer, the light is with you. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. He who walks in darkness does not know where he's going. While you have the light, believe in the light, that you may become sons of light." These things Jesus spoke and departed and was hidden from them. So this is, in a public sense, Jesus' final call to faith and repentance. Remember, it's Passover time. Crowds are gathered there in Jerusalem. So he's dealing with these crowds, the people that are standing by, not so much preaching to vast multitudes, but he's talking to his disciples. People are hanging around. We saw in our last study, people were hearing the things that he was saying. And so there was some little amount of interaction. And Jesus says, this is your opportunity to recognize the light that is among you. He said, I'm the light. I'm here now. But he's marching to the cross, and he knows that. And so he says, you need to believe and receive, trust in, have faith in that light while that light is among you, because that opportunity is going to be removed. So verse 37 says, although he had done so many signs before them, they did not believe in him, that the word of Isaiah the prophet might be fulfilled, which he spoke. Lord, who has believed our report? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? Now, when John writes this, he is quoting from Isaiah chapter 53. In fact, it is verse 1 of Isaiah chapter 53. If John were to have, or Jesus or John, or any of the disciples, any one of them had grabbed a scroll and read Isaiah 53 to the Jews that were standing around there in that temple area at that Passover time, that should have probably been all they would ever need to believe that Jesus is the promised Messiah. Isaiah 53 lays it out clearly. But it's interesting because most of us that study the scripture, we know, yes, Isaiah 53 is a messianic passage. It talks about the coming Christ. It is prophetic of what Jesus would do in his first coming, which is part of the reason why they missed it. Because they were looking for him to come as conquering king, which he will do in his second coming, not in his first coming. Completely missed the dichotomy of two comings of Jesus Christ. So it's interesting that we know Isaiah 53 talks about the Christ before he came, and yet verse 1 of that passage starts out acknowledging that there would be unbelief. So indulge me, if you will, for a few moments while I read that entire chapter for you. Who has believed our report? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant and as a root out of dry ground. He has no form or comeliness. And when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who will declare his generation? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people he was stricken. And they made his grave with the wicked, but with the rich at his death, because he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Father to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When you make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the labor of his soul and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant shall justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bore the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. How clear is that? This is Jesus' life and ministry laid out over 1,000 years before he showed up on the earth, by Isaiah the prophet. And yet, that entire passage, so clear in who the Messiah was, Isaiah begins it by saying, who has believed us? Who has seen the Lord and believed as he's revealed himself to them? This is why John says in verse 39, therefore they could not believe.
Because Isaiah said again, he has blinded their eyes and hardened their hearts, lest they should see with their eyes, lest they should understand with their hearts and turn, so that I should heal them. Now, this is fascinating what John does here, because he starts by quoting Isaiah 53, then he goes back to Isaiah chapter 6, verse 10. It's a passage that, again, is familiar. Even if you're not a Old Testament scholar, many, many Christians are familiar with Isaiah chapter 6, verse 10. In the year King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. He was high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. It's the passage where Isaiah receives his call to ministry. He's told to go to the people and speak the word of the Lord to them. But in that passage in Isaiah chapter 6 in verse 10, the Lord tells Isaiah the people won't be receptive to your message. They will be unreceptive. And John now equates the same attitude to the people in Jesus' day. Because all through the Old Testament, God says of his people Israel, they are a stubborn and stiff-necked people. Can you imagine when God tells you you're a pain in the neck? Oh, by the way, I have my laugh track again. Can you imagine when God has to tell you you're a pain in the neck? Okay, I'm sorry. That was probably not accurate. Can you imagine when God has to tell you you're a pain in the neck? All right, is that better? All right. More accurate. See, here's the deal. God says of my people, you constantly turn away from me. You constantly harden your heart. You're constantly unreceptive to the things that I'm trying to speak to you and the things that I'm doing for you. And here John is pointing out that the people of Israel, God's people, are doing the exact same thing when the Messiah is right in front of them. They rejected the light that was among them. And now they're at the place where they could not believe. And it says so right there in verse 39. Therefore, they could not believe. And then he likens that to what Isaiah had prophesied, the same one that prophesied of the coming of Messiah. Says, God says to Isaiah, they're not going to listen to you. They're not going to believe you. John says they're still not listening. They're still not believing. So now, verse 39, they could not believe. Now, immediately, some will read that and cry, well, that's not fair. That's not fair for God to hold them responsible if they could not believe. What does that mean? Well, you have to take this in keeping with verse 37. That's why I made sure I didn't go through verse 37 and then cut it off last week. 37 and 39 have to be seen together. Verse 37, although Jesus had done so many signs before them, they did not believe in him. Verse 39, therefore they could not believe. Now, probably like me, many of your minds go immediately back to Pharaoh in Egypt. We read there that ultimately God hardened Pharaoh's heart. But God doesn't do that until after we see repeatedly Pharaoh hardened his heart. Pharaoh hardened his heart. Pharaoh hardened his heart. And then it's as if God says, okay, have it your way. You want your heart hardened? Granted. And he solidifies Pharaoh's heart in the position in which Pharaoh had set it. God is solidifying these people's hearts in the place where they had set them. And this is a biblical truth. It is a scary proposition if we are in rebellion against God, isn't it? That there may come a day when we have said no, 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 no to the Lord year after year after year. And so many people banking on, well, when I get older, I'll serve the Lord. When I get older, I'll walk with the Lord. Maybe I'll accept the Lord on my deathbed. Maybe. I believe that happens. I have seen that happen. But more often, I've seen it not happen. Because ultimately, many times, we develop a pattern. Just like our brains can be patterned, our spirit can be patterned. And it seems as if God will solidify our decision either way. Listen, if you accept the Lord, if you are open to the leading of the Lord, if you are willing to learn how to say yes to the things that God is telling you, then God will set you firmly in that condition. But if you rebel and continue to reject the conviction of the Holy Spirit in your heart, it will eventually be patterned, your heart will, in that condition. I liken it to knitting. Now you're all looking at me like I've lost my mind. I can tell. I can see you through the camera. Besides, even the AV people are looking at me like I've lost my mind. I liken it to knitting. I have watched my wife knit. She doesn't knit often, but once she decides that she's going to knit something, it takes only a few minutes, and she's back into it, and she can have a conversation, and she can watch TV, and she could deal with the grandchildren, and she can do everything while she's knitting. Just keep her right on going. And it's like, how do you do that? Well, first of all, she's a woman, and women can multitask like men can't possibly do in most cases. But the fact is that that movement just gets patterned in our brain. So I've been told. I'm not much of a knitter, but I have done it. And once you just kind of get in the rhythm and those grooves are made in your brain, it's just like second nature and you can do it. I couldn't do it now if my life depended on it. But I'm sure it would come back. But listen, in the same way, our spirit is patterned each time we reject the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's why 90% of people who express faith and trust in Jesus Christ do so first before they ever get out of the early years of high school. Because once you continue to reject and reject and reject and reject, those patterns are formed in your spirit. That's what the Bible calls the unpardonable sin. Jesus called it the unpardonable sin. When we reject the work of the Holy Spirit, what is the work of the Holy Spirit to the person who's a non-believer? The work of the Holy Spirit in the life of a person who does not believe in Jesus Christ is to call them to belief in Jesus Christ. And if you say no and no and no and no and reject it and reject it, and you never change and transition to a point where you receive that, the Bible says that is the unpardonable sin, rejecting Jesus Christ as Lord and as Savior. Now, one more side note before we move on from those verses. It really doesn't, it's just one of those things that has always fascinated me. There's a group of people out there, I will call them liberal pseudo-scholars, okay? They fancy themselves to be scholars, but I think they're guys who have merely been educated beyond their intelligence. These folks that sit in these ivory towers and try to come up with new takes on the Bible and all this kind of stuff have come up with the idea that the book of Isaiah is actually written by two different authors. Now, why did they come up with that idea? Because there are internal inconsistencies? No. Because there is some archaeological evidence or textual evidence? No. It's simply because they discount the idea that Isaiah could know what was going to happen 1,000 years later before it happened. There's no way that Isaiah could foretell the future with this kind of detail. Therefore, there must have been another author that wrote after these things happened. But again, they have to start with a premise. The premise is that there's no way that he could have spoken these things 1,000 years before it happened. Therefore, there must have been a second author. Here's the bottom line. They neither know the scriptures nor the power of God. The same as the people Jesus said that to initially. You are in error because you don't know the scriptures nor the power of God. Isn't it interesting that John right here quotes from Isaiah 53 and then from Isaiah 6, which are both in different halves, these presumed halves that these scholars say were written by different authors, and John ascribes them to the same author. Of course, they're so much smarter than the Apostle John was. Verse 41, these things Isaiah said when he saw his glory and spoke of him. Now think about what John is saying here. These things Isaiah said that the people would not believe. Isaiah wrote that the Lord told him the people would not believe. And then by chapter 53, Isaiah says, Lord, who's going to believe us? Who's going to believe what we say to them? Why did he say that? Because in chapter 6, God had already told you, Isaiah, they're not going to listen to you. And then he's got all those chapters in between of speaking the word of the Lord and the people not listening to him. But notice John says that Isaiah said all of this in chapter 6 when he saw his glory and spoke of him. Who is John talking about? Jesus. So when Isaiah says those words, in the year King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. He was high and lifted up. The train of his robe filled the temple. And above it stood seraphim. Each one had six wings. With two he covered his face, with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one cried to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And the posts of the door were shaken by the voice of him who cried out, and the house was filled with smoke. And Isaiah's watching all of this, and he's so overcome. He's so blown out. He says, "Woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." And who does John say he saw on the throne? Jesus. John is right here clearly, unequivocally equating Jesus with the Father. Jesus is God. Okay? John makes it clear. Now, verse 42. "Nevertheless, even among the rulers, many believed in him, but because of the Pharisees, they did not confess him, lest they should be put out of the synagogue, for they loved the praise of men more than the praise of God." Now, evidently, when he's talking about religious leaders here, the rulers listed there or mentioned there in verse 42, he's not talking about the Sanhedrin. He's not talking about the Pharisees and the Sadducees there in Jerusalem. Remember, it's Passover time. All of the synagogue rulers from each of the little cities, there would have been a synagogue in Bethany, there would have been a synagogue in Bethlehem, and all of those communities had a synagogue. Every synagogue had a ruler of the synagogue. They would have all been there. And many of them are believing. So the larger portion of the population is disbelieving, but God always has a remnant. And there are always those who will believe. And evidently, many of the rulers believed in Jesus because they knew the scriptures. And they could see that he was fulfilling them. But there was a problem. They were afraid to go public with it because they knew if they did, they'd lose their position in the synagogue. They knew they'd lose their preeminence among the people. They knew that they would be ostracized from their entire community in their city or their village. Now, ultimately, two of the Pharisees will actually step forward publicly with their faith. Nick and Joe, right? Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea, when they come to take the body of Christ down, they will publicly identify as his followers. But at this point, many of the rulers, they're afraid. They're afraid to publicly say that they are going to follow Jesus. And how tragic when we look at that, and how tragic when we think how often we fail in this very area. Gang, there will often be a cost in following Jesus. There will often be a cost to following Jesus. And what I'm watching in our culture now, because our culture is changing so fast, never mind this coronavirus thing, I'm hoping that God uses that as some kind of a wake-up for some folks, that there would be revival and repentance in our nation. And I'm praying desperately for that. But just looking at how our culture has changed in the last 10 years, it is absolutely phenomenal, the rate of change. Well, and here's the deal. Less and less people are being willing to pay that cost today that it takes to follow Jesus. They're less and less willing to take the cost upon themselves. So churches start embracing what the world is embracing. Churches start embracing the culture. Now let me make it clear where we stand at Springs Lighthouse. We don't have to be hateful. We should not be hateful. But we still need to declare that the Word of God is what sets our standard, not the culture. The Word of God sets our standard. We don't have to be obnoxious jerks, especially when it comes to the things of God. I have a tendency to be an obnoxious jerk in other things, but my family are not here to say that was on. I think my wife paid Kent to yell amen. But listen, we need to stand on the fact that Jesus is the only way to salvation. That is what the scripture declares. It's not what our culture likes. And so many churches are kind of, they want to pull back from that and adopt this attitude that, yes, all are welcome. We're all the children of God. And we don't want to preach on the blood of Jesus Christ because it might be offensive to people. Well, I'm sorry, we don't have to preach offensively, but the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ is going to be offensive sometimes. Because people have to be confronted with sin. And who likes that? And even as believers, we don't like being confronted by our sin, do we? So the reality is there may be a cost in following Jesus. These weren't prepared to pay it. I wonder sometimes if I am. Well, verse 44, then Jesus cried out and said, "He who believes in me believes not in me, but in him who sent me." Now here's the idea of what he's saying. He who believes in me believes not in me alone, but in him who sent me. And what is Jesus doing? Once again, linking himself to God, just like John did earlier. And if you doubt that, look at verse 45. He who sees me sees him who sent me. There you go. Couldn't be more clear than that. He says, "I have come as a light into the world." Remember what we read in verses 35 and 36? Picking up on the same thought again. "I have come as a light into the world, that whoever believes in me should not abide in darkness. And if anyone hears my words and does not believe, I do not judge him. For I did not come to judge the world, but to save the world." Now this is the same thing that Jesus said that John recorded previously in his gospel. Look at what Jesus is saying in verses 46 and 47. He's talking about his love for us in these verses. The first thing he says is that he desires to have us walk in light rather than stumbling around in darkness. That's nice of him. I hate stumbling around in the darkness. It just seems like when you run into something in the dark, it hurts so much more than it would. Ever run into a chair or something in the dark? Yeah, it hurts more than the daytime, because even when you turn around and you hit something, at that last second, you see it coming. In the dark, you don't get to see it. I am convinced still to this day, though my kids are grown and moved out of the house, that is why they got up in the middle of the night and planted Legos in the path. So that in the darkness, I would step on those Legos. Stepping on Legos in the dark hurts even worse than stepping on them in the light. I have a dog who sleeps on a pillow. Both of them sleep on a pillow on the floor at the foot of the bed. But Sadie sleeps on Janine's side. Optimus sleeps on my side. He's a 95-pound pit bull mix. He's a beast. And apparently, he's too big for his pillow. Or at least he has convinced himself that he is. So in the middle of the night, he decides that he's going to lay half on and half off the pillow. And the half off is right in between me and my path to the bathroom. So if I get up in the middle of the night because I gotta go, I end up tripping over this massive dog. He doesn't move. It's like he doesn't even feel it. He's got a head. I think his head is like 50 pounds of his body weight. And so I kick him in the head. I don't mean to. I just don't see him. And I trip over him and I half fall down and I look back and I can just make him out in the dark and he just doesn't even move. He's like, whatever. And I'm half dead. It's not good to stumble around in the darkness. Jesus says, I don't want you to stumble in the darkness. I have come as a light into the world, that whoever believes in me should not abide in darkness. He came in his first coming, we read right here, not to bring condemnation, but to bring salvation. That is his love for us, gang. He could have come and judged us. They could have put that first nail into him, or let's say they succeeded in nailing him to that cross, lifting him up, began to mock him. He could have said, enough of this, and judged all of mankind at that moment. He could have called and 10,000s of angels would have come to assist him. As if he needed it, he holds all things together by the word of his power. He could have looked at one of those frothing at the mouth Pharisees at the bottom of the, or at the foot of the cross, and just said, dissolve, and that would have happened. Just that simple. But he didn't come in his first coming to judge. All of us know John 3:16, and we should. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. But gang, let me encourage you to memorize verse 17 as well. Because it says, God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. We need to be able to make that distinction. Jesus came in his first coming, not to judge the world, but to save the world. In his second coming, he's coming as judge. When he returns, he will come as judge. Now he says in verse 48, he who rejects me and does not receive my words has that which judges him. The word that I have spoken will judge him in the last day. And what a statement. Jesus says, I'm not here to judge you now. I'm here to bring salvation. But let me explain this to you. I don't need to judge you. If you reject me, you reject my words. And when you stand before the Father, those words will judge you. I wonder what that scene is going to be like. I wonder if God isn't going to look over at Gabriel, the angel, and say, Gabe, roll the tape. And Gabe rolls how many times a person had an opportunity to hear the word of the Lord and reject it. How many times they heard the words of Jesus and rejected it. How many times someone told them, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. And they said, I don't believe there's only one way. You know, if somebody came out tomorrow, well, it'd have to be anybody except President Trump. If Trump said there was a cure, no, half the country would just say, oh, Trump said it, I'm not taking it, which is really sad. But if somebody came out tomorrow with a cure for the coronavirus, take this pill, no more problem. How many people do you think would stand up and go, only one cure? There's only one pill? I don't know if I like that one. I want to make my own pill. Doesn't somebody else have a pill I can take? You wouldn't hear any of that. People would be lined up for that one way to be healed. The one way to salvation. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you reject those words, you will be judged by those words in the day of judgment, which will take place at the second coming. Verse 49, he says, for I have not spoken on my own authority, but the Father who sent me gave me a command, what I should say and what I should speak. And I know that his command is everlasting life. Therefore, whatever I speak, just as the Father has told me, so I speak. Some people just see that word command and they get all tense. Nobody likes the idea of somebody commanding them to do something. Because our flesh rebels against yielding to any authority at all. Isn't that the truth? How many of you have just even chafed the fact that our governor, okay, so he's intellectually challenged, but besides that, the fact that he gives an order, and everybody's like, what does he mean? He's giving an order. What is it? I don't have to obey his order. We have the Bill of Rights. And people just chafe at that. I do it myself. My initial reaction is, he can't do that. Even though we're in the middle of a pandemic. But the Bible commands me to obey until the point that he issues an order that says I can't do what God commands me to do. Then we're going to have a problem. But listen, some of his orders actually make sense, proving, if nothing else, that even a broken clock is right twice a week or twice a day, right? But why do we chafe against it? We just don't like authority. We don't like anyone telling us what to do. But good grief, if anyone can tell us what we're supposed to do, it's our Creator. And when Jesus says this, the Father who sent me gave me a command, what I should say and what I should speak. And I know that his command is what? Everlasting life. What a tragedy that we wouldn't obey the command that brings us everlasting life. Jesus in another place said, my commands are not burdensome. They're life. And everlasting life at that. Jesus comes to show us the way and we convince ourselves he came to blow us away. He came to show us the way. His command is eternal life for all of those who believe. Are you looking for eternal life? Look to the one who gives it. Look to the one who has life within himself and the one who makes life worth living. Well, Father, we thank you so much for your word. We thank you for the command that you have given, that if we will but simply believe and trust in you, and what you did through your Son at the cross for our salvation, that we can be saved. Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, And all man had to do was to look to that serpent lifted up on that pole, and they would be delivered from the sting, the poison, the bite of the serpent. Lord Jesus was made to be sin for us and lifted up on that cross so that if we would look to him, we would be saved. Lord, forgive us for our sinful, rebellious hearts. And how often it is that we tend to shy away from doing the simple things that you ask of us. God, may our hearts remain tender toward you. Father, we don't want to get ourselves to a place where our hearts are hardened and we find them set there in that condition. May our hearts remain soft, supple in your hands, able to be worked by the power of your Holy Spirit. And Father, as we take communion together tonight, Lord, remind us of what it costs to purchase our redemption. Remind us of a little bit of what it means that the one who knew no sin became sin for us, that we might become your righteousness through him. Lord, you see us righteous right now. That's amazing because we know we're not. But you see us that way because we are robed with the righteousness of Christ. And that was made available to us by what Jesus did for us at the cross. So, Father, as we approach your table, as we hold in our hand the bread that represents the body of Christ, Lord, may we remember Jesus' body broken for us at Calvary. Let's take the bread together. And Father, as we hold this cup in our hand, we remember the blood of Jesus Christ, precious as it was, and the life that is in the blood that was poured out for us from that cross, that we might receive your righteousness, that your wrath passes over us because it was satisfied by Jesus, the Passover lamb, and we take that cup together. And Lord, we will do this until Jesus comes as we remember him.
He became sin, knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself, carried the cross, love so
Father, you are Lord of all. Jesus, you are Lord of all. Spirit, you are Lord of all. Lord, fill us to overflowing. May we go from this place or that place or whatever place people are in right now. And may we be used by your mighty hand to bless others, to encourage others through a phone call, through a card, a note, a message. Lord, prompt us by your Spirit in ways that we can minister, that we don't simply find ourselves in this time taking in and taking in and taking in and receiving of your Spirit, of your word, of your goodness, and not giving out as well. Lord, teach us what it means to be creative. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thanks for joining us. See you next week.